In 485 BC, the land of Israel, conquered by the Babylonians, was a wasteland, uninhabited except for a few peasants eking out a bare existence. This was the land God had promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and to their descendants forever.
For all the land your eye can see, to you I will give it, and to your descendants forever. The land shall not be sold forever, for the land is mine.
The once proud inhabitants of the promised land had been slaughtered, scattered, and carried to Babylon, where they had spent 70 years, as Jeremiah had prophesied.
This whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment, and you shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years.
Many Jews had returned to Jerusalem to rebuild the temple, but the city itself still lay desolate, its walls broken down and its gates burned. In that hopeless hour, God spoke through Zechariah, one of the most remarkable prophecies ever recorded. It concerned what the Bible calls the last days.
Behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling. I will make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people.
The fulfillment of this prophecy, following the amazing rebirth of Israel in 1948, has been witnessed by the world. Exactly as the Bible foretold, not New York, Berlin, or Moscow, but tiny Jerusalem is the world's greatest burden. So great is it that the United Nations Security Council has devoted nearly a third of its deliberations to Israel, which has 1/1000 of the Earth's population. Jerusalem would not be the UN's number one problem if Israel could be pushed around, but her military is the best in the world.
In that day will I make the governors of Judah a torch of fire, and they shall devour all the people round about. The Lord shall defend the inhabitants of Jerusalem.
Exactly as foretold, Israel has devoured her attackers, winning every war against overwhelming odds. The angel Gabriel told Daniel that Jerusalem would be rebuilt, that 483 years later, Messiah would come. His own people, Israel, would reject and crucify him, and the city and temple would be destroyed again. And so it happened.
And after shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself and the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary.
Jesus rode into Jerusalem on the very day prophesied, was hailed as the Messiah, then rejected. Jesus prophesied,
Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And they shall be led away captive into all nations.
In AD 70, exactly as Jesus foretold, the Roman armies under Titus sacked Jerusalem and left not one stone of Herod's temple upon another. More than 1 million Jews were killed, and the remnant were scattered to every nation.
You shall be plucked from off the land you are about to possess, and the Lord shall scatter you among all people, from the one end of the earth even unto the other.
Israel's prophets also foretold the anti-Semitism that would pursue the Jews everywhere.
To be a curse, an astonishment, and a hissing, and a reproach among all the nations.
Scattered to every nation, Jews have been hated, persecuted, and killed like no other people, while the barren land of Israel continued to mourn. In 1867, a visiting Mark Twain wrote,
"Bethlehem, where the angels sang, is untenanted of any living creature. Palestine sits in sackcloth and ashes, desolate and unlovely."
In another remarkable prophecy, Jesus declared,
"Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled."
Jerusalem has been fought over by every major power in history. The Babylonians held it, then the Medes and Persians. Alexander the Great took Palestine for the Greeks in 333 BC. Later, the Egyptians and Syrians alternately had it until the Romans. Islamic invaders took control to be replaced by the Crusaders. Later, the Islamic Mamluks of Egypt possessed Jerusalem. Then the Ottoman Turkish Empire ruled for about 400 years. And all through these centuries, the Jews lived there and suffered. Fulfilled Bible prophecies concerning Israel, Jerusalem, and the Jew provide irrefutable proof of God's existence and that the Bible is true. Most people think the Roman Catholic Crusaders freed the Holy Land for the Jews. In fact, they slaughtered the Jews and took that land for the Catholic Church. Pope Urban II, who organized the First Crusade, urged the Crusaders to start upon the road to the Holy Sepulchre, to wrest that land from the wicked race and subject it to yourselves. Hordes of volunteers, under the banner of the cross, massacred Christ's earthly brethren, the Jews, all along the route to Jerusalem. The crusade leader, Godfrey of Bouillon, vowed to avenge the blood of Jesus upon the Jews, leaving not one alive. Upon taking the city of David, the crusaders chased the Jews into the synagogue and set it ablaze. Succeeding popes treated Jews as lepers without rights. Among them, Pius VII, Leo XII, Pius VIII, Gregory XVI. Hitler's abuse of German Jews leading up to World War II uncovered a simmering anti-Semitism that was actually worldwide. The ocean liner St. Louis, crammed with 1,100 Jewish refugees, was turned away from every port in South, Central, and North America. Those 700 had valid papers for entering the U.S. President Roosevelt sent them back to perish in Hitler's ovens. Even Switzerland turned fleeing Jews back to their murderers and acted as Hitler's banker, holding billions of dollars for the Nazis in gold and funds stolen from Jewish victims. By the end of World War II, God's promise to bring